Welcome back, everybody. And now, as I promised, we'll look at more general theorems on martingale convergence. So remember the question that the meta example that we had in the beginning. When can a martingale be generated by one function, which is f infinity measurable? So here we'll partially answer this question, and then we'll have necessary insufficient condition a bit later. And so first we start with a situation when you have a martingale, which is continuous on continuous time, which is uniformly LP bounded. So not only this expectation is finite, they are uniformly bounded. And of course, P is bigger than one as promised. And the claim is that in this situation, you can find X infinity, which belongs to LP and F infinity measurable, such that XT converges to X infinity both almost surely and in LP. That only happens for P less than infinity. You can't assume that bounded martingale uniformly converges somewhere. That's cannot happen, but again, this is reminiscent of situation in a hard space situation. And finally, that's what we want, that XT can be restored from X infinity by taking conditional expectations. So if you are uniformly in LP, there is an LP function in infinity which generates your martingale. Again, if time is continuous, you need to assume continuity. First, let us remark that, of course, it's enough to prove everything for P less than infinity, because L infinity, of course, is subset is LP, and almost sure limit of function from L infinity, of course, belongs to L infinity. And we never claim that there is a convergence on L infinity. So in the rest of the proof, we will assume that P is less than infinity, but bigger than one. Now, what we would do, we would use duality exactly as in Cardy space. We'll take subsequence xtk, which converges LP weakly, meaning for every LQ function, integral of this with respect to xtk converges somewhere, and it converges to some x. Since all of the xtk are x is also f infinity measurable. So far again, we just know that x is a weak limit of xdk. If we would show that this x does not depend on choice of tk, that would immediately imply convergence in LP and the fact that it belongs to LP because, again, weak limit by definition is an element of LP. And to establish this, we actually start with proving this, that XT is expectation of X infinity with respect to XT. So let us fix S and let's take A belonging to FS for some S. So S is not a stopping time here, S is just a time S. Then characteristic function of A belongs to LQ. So if you want to compute integral of AX, this is just the limit of integrals of XTK of A, right? So because by definition of a convergence. So this is the same as integral of A of XTK dP. And then for TK bigger than S, you have this identity. So when tk becomes bigger than s, surprise, surprise, this integral becomes equal to this. So what we just proved just from the weak convergence that xs is expectation of x with respect to fs. Okay, now f infinity is a minimal sigma algebra which contains all the FS. And you know expectation of X with respect to any of this sigma algebras FS. Then it's the standard second measure theory. This uniquely, well, almost surely, defines X. And so by compactness, of course, XT itself weakly converges to X. Again, not yet LP converges, but so far it converges weakly. And we have this identity. So this is a somewhat twisted way to see it. First, we start with proving this identity, which just follows from weak convergence. This implies uniqueness of X. This in turn implies weak convergence to X. Okay, so now let us try to get almost sure and LP convergence. Let us define variation of X at infinity at the process of omega is simply lim sub minus lim inf. We want this to be zero. We know that it's almost surely fine because by one of the previous corollaries, lim sub of absolute value of XT is bounded. Also, probability that it's bigger than epsilon is bounded by the probability that lim sup of absolute value is bigger than epsilon over 2. It's bounded by 2 of epsilon integral of x infinity in dp. Okay, so now how does the proof proceed for Hardy space in this situation? You say, okay, suppose that you're in a dense subset of continuous functions. Then for continuous functions, you have much nicer convergence. And then this maximal inequality would imply everything. So here, the role of continuous function would be played by predictable functions. So the functions which are FS measurable for some S. So the functions which are just, which just depend on what happens up to time S. So this is D, and D is dense in LP. Again, because F infinity is generated by all the sigma Fs. So this is dense in LP. So what does it mean? It means that for every epsilon, you can find J epsilon such that expectation of X minus J epsilon to the P is bounded by epsilon to the 2P. So which means, remember, we want this to be small. I want so expectation of X minus J epsilon is bounded by epsilon squared by standard Young inequality. Now observe that omega of J epsilon is zero because of course lim sup of XT is equal to lim inf of XT is XS. Remember, if X was G, then everything would stop at time S because G is FS measurable. There would be no change. And now we write it as, so probability that omega S is bigger than epsilon is the same as probability that omega of X minus J epsilon is bigger than epsilon. Subtracting J epsilon doesn't affect the limit. And now we can use this estimate to see that this is bounded by 2 over epsilon times epsilon squared, which is 2 epsilon. So probability that variation of omega X is big, it's actually, well, small. So omega X is actually equal to zero almost surely, because again, probability that it's bigger than epsilon is bounded by 2 epsilon. And so the limit of XT exists almost surely. at is it x? So for this, we'll need some extra steps. But first, let us establish that actually you have LP convergence to x. So here, things are easy. The difference between xt and x in LP is bounded by the difference between xt and j epsilon also in LP, and the difference between j epsilon x in LP, well, that's standard. Now, what is the difference between xt and j epsilon, at least for t bigger than s? It's expectation of xt minus j epsilon with respect to ft to the power p. Then you take expectation, take it to the power 1 over p plus this difference. So, but again, this is bounded by j epsilon minus x in LP. So here I should remove t. So this x minus j epsilon to the p with respect to ft. So this thing also bounded by this j epsilon minus x. Again, so this is again another application of Young inequality. So this is bounded by 2 epsilon squared. So LP norm of this happily tends to zero. And then the question is, well, this is all great. Why is y equal to x? One way to see it is to say, okay, xt converges to x in LP. So there is a subsequence which converges almost surely. But this is because there exists xt and convergence to x almost surely, which means that of course. And this, so just to notice that this, of course, finishes
You are muted, Ilya.
Thank you. I'm back. Sorry for this interruption. Let me try to share. Okay. My screen again. So, okay. So actually, I got interrupted in a good moment. We just finished showing that the proof of the theorem, that there is an easy way to see it, that actually xt converges to almost surely to x, which is LP limit of xt. Now let us try to show it by another way, which is more complicated, but which will lead to a much more general theorem. So we call family of processes or a process xt uniformly integrable if two conditions hold. First is that for every epsilon So now, of course, my computer decided to act up, not just my internet connection. Well, it's one of those days. Okay. So we two conditions here. We assume that if measure of the set is small, then integral over the set of xt is less than epsilon. And second is that supremum of the all the integrals, so they are uniform integrables, expectation of xt is bounded of infinity. Now, if you are an analyst, condition two is unfamiliar to you, because for all normal measures that we like and use, say for Lebesgue measure, for any non-atomic measure, condition one implies condition two. You just subdivide your set into small subsets of size delta, and then this condition implies that supremum of integrals is small. But in probability, they want to deal with abstract measures, so that's why there are these two conditions. Now, observe that if you are uniformly bounded in LP, like we had in our theorem, then your uniformly integral simply by Chebyshev inequality. Indeed, integral over set of small measure by Young is bounded by probability of e to the power 1 over q times LP norm of xt on e, but of course this is bounded by delta to the power 1 over q supremum of this expectation. So as long as the supremum is bounded, your uniform integral. And this uniform integrability condition would give us everything. Now, one thing we all learned in our analysis course is that if you have uniformly integrable family and it converges to some y almost surely, then it also converges to this y in L1, that the norm tends to zero. That's actually the right condition for convergence, and here I outline the proof. So it's this integral of the difference is bounded by, well, first you look at the probability that you are less or equal than epsilon, and then xn minus y is less or equal than epsilon. This is bounded by epsilon times this probability, because xn minus y on this set is bounded by epsilon, plus the probability that you are bigger. So probability that xn minus y is bigger than epsilon. And this in turn goes to zero. Probability that you are bigger than epsilon goes to zero. That's that's what almost sure convergence guarantees you, because almost sure convergence implies convergence in probability. And so this thing is bounded by epsilon for large n, and this thing is bounded by epsilon. So for large n, this is bounded by 2 epsilon. That's exactly what we wanted. And of course, this observation implies that since this already goes to zero in LP, in our theorem, then x is equal to y, because we know that xt also converges to y. Let me, for consistency, write here. Okay, it turns out that actually uniform integrability is the key to understanding all these convergence theorems. So, the next series of theorem is due to Dube, and we will finally answer in if and only if terms the question of when martingale is generated by a single function and the question about convergence. First is, Dupe's martingale convergence. And here there is no uniform integrability yet. So suppose that Xt is a submartingale, which is, as usual, continuous for continuous times. And suppose that it has bounded suprema. Then there exists limit, almost sure. So remember, we just know that Lim-Sup is bounded. But what I claim is that there exists limit. And again, here, it's as you will see from the proof, it's enough to assume that supremum of expectation of positive part of Xt, maximum of Xt is zero, is bounded. But it's easy to convince yourself that this is the same. And of course, same is true for supermartingales Xt with supremum of now Xt minus, minimum of Xt and zero, or finite. And this, all you need to do is consider submartingale minus Xt. So Dupe's maximal convergence theorem is true for supermartingales as long as you assume something like this. But again, for submartingales, this is actually equivalent to this. For supermartingales, this is equivalent to this. Okay, so proof is actually not that easy. It relies on a following lemma, and I was hesitant whether to include it here, but actually this is so important for understanding lots of things going on with martingales that I will include. Okay, so let's look at a function f defined on R plus, or maybe on, if the time is discrete, on natural numbers. Let's just consider some partition. So let's consider finitely many times d. F is a partition. And S1 would be the first time you are above b. Then S2 would be the first time bigger than S1 when you are below a. And in general, for odd numbers, you want to be the first time above b after you hit after a, and this is below a. So let's look at example here. So here is in this is t1, t2, t3, and so on. And at the time t1, you are still below a. The first time you when you are above b is the time t2. Then the first time after this, when you are below A, is T5. And T6 is S3 here, because again, you are immediately after A. And then convention. Minimum of empty set is TD. So if this was your last visit above B or below A, that's it. After that, your time is TD. And now this D of F of AB, this is supreme over all partitions of F of the interval AB of this guys, D, F, F, AB, this is maximum of N such that S to N is less than TD. Remember when there is nothing left, when you don't down cross anymore, you just say, okay, this would be TD. So this is number of crossings from B to A. So this is the number of times you cross from above B to below A. And the amazing lemma, which of course is also due to Dupe, is that if you have a supermartingale, then expectation of this guy is actually bounded by the expectation of by the supremum of xt minus b plus, expectation of xt minus b plus. Okay, so primum of all partitions. That's why it defines this way to be inherently stable, to be inherently finite. Okay, so notice that each SK is a stopping time. And let us define AK, which is omega such that SK less than TD, so that SK really exists, that you really made, well, for even one up crossing for odd, rather for even one down crossing for odd ones up crossing K over two times. So this is AK, this is an element of FSK. Notice that, of course, AK is a subset of AK, sorry, rather. AK plus one is subset of AK. If you crossed K, times on A to N equals B, on A to N, again, by definition. That's because at the moment, okay, and it seems that I understand. Okay, I'm connected back. Okay, so now let us just integrate x s to n minus one minus b over the set A to n minus one. Remember, A to n minus one belongs to F S to n minus one. So by sub-martingale property, this integral is bounded by this integral. Because conditional expectation of X S to n is bigger or equal than X S to n minus one. But this integral, of course, is bigger or equal than A. You jumped over B. But let's bound this. So x s to n is actually less than a on n, on a to n. Plus, you also have this guy on a to n minus one minus a to n, this integral left. So you separate your set a to n minus one into subset a to n, where x s to n is less than a, and the rest, where is just this integral. But on this set, x s to n is equal actually to td. And so what we get is that b minus a, so let's put it to this side, we get that b minus a, p probability of a to n is bounded by the integral of x td minus b. And to make it a nice inequality, let's put a little plus here. It's still inequality, right? Because it would be true even without plus, without maximum. So we can do that. Now, A to N is the set where the number of crossings is bigger than N. These things, they're disjoint for different N, of course. So let's now sum it up. And we get exactly this. Again, by Lake principle. This is bounded by the supremum. And again, we just checked it for arbitrary partition. So for arbitrary partition is bounded, supremum is bounded. End of story. Okay, and now using this exciting theorem, we are ready to give a very quick proof of our exciting dup theorem that the limit exists. Suppose that it's not almost sure convergent. Then there exists some a and b such that liminf is less than a and limsup is bigger than b with positive probability. So the number of crossings of AB is actually infinite with positive probability. But you see expectation of this number of crossings is on the other hand finite. That's a contradiction, that's it. So that's all there is to it. Again, so just clever use of finite optional stopping times here. And now with this exciting development, we are ready to answer the question of when is XT generated by some X infinity. So when XT is equal to expectation of X infinity with respect to FT. Okay, so the next theorem, again by Dup, is that the following are equivalent. Okay, if I wrote TFIE, then of course I didn't need to write equivalent, so let me erase E. So let us take a martingale XT, assume to be continuous, at continuous time. And the following are equivalent. First, that XT converges NL1. When t goes to infinity. Second is our condition that x expectation of x infinity with respect to ft is equal to xt. And third is that xt is uniformly integrable. So the moment you're uniformly integrable, it means that you are generated by this and you converge in L1 to this function xt infinity. Okay, let's prove everything. So two implies three. Well, this is obvious because x infinity itself was absolutely continuous. Every integrable function is absolutely continuous. Absolutely continuously integrable, sorry, absolutely integrable. So which means that the properties, well, for every epsilon that exists, delta, they carry out to functions xt, of course. Because integral of xt over any set is the same as integral of x infinity. So if integral of x infinity is small, integral of xt is small. One implies two. Well, that's also easy. Because expectation of x infinity with respect to ft, since we have convergence in L1, this is just expectation of xt plus s with respect to st. And this expectation was xt. So that's also easy. So one implies two, that's trivial. And the non-trivial part is three implies one. So if you are uniformly integrable, then you have an L1 limit. But by Dup, it won't be too complicated. Because we know that by Dup there exists this almost surely. That's by Dup theorem. But now you have uniform integrability. You know that uniform integrability, in the case of uniform integrability, almost sure convergence easily implies L1 convergence. And then we are done. So this is the condition. If your martingale is uniformly integrable, it's representable, and vice versa. And now we are ready to prove this general optional stopping time theorem. So suppose that you have a martingale and you have two stopping times. Well, first thing is that if T is bounded, then expectation of XS, conditional expectation for T with respect to FS is XS. So this is generalization of our discrete stopping time theorem, where we had exactly the same condition. But now, if X is uniformly integrable, then XS is actually equal to expectation of X infinity with respect to FS. And in the process, it's also equal. Okay, so let's return to the proof of this general optional stopping time theorem. So before this unintended break, we saw that our notion of uniform integrability allows us to say that if your martingale is uniformly integrable, then optional stopping time theorem calls for any stopping times. And first, let us note that the first part was about bounded stopping times implied by the second part, because XT is uniformly integrable for bounded times, because XT is expectation of XM with respect to FT. So if your times are bounded, then you have this final thing. Now, to prove two, it's enough to prove just this part. Because then XS is expectation. Remember, we just pass the expectation through FT. So this is the same as expectation of XT with respect to FS. Okay, so all we are proving now is that this is equal to this. Now observe that the family of expectation of X infinity with respect to B, where B is any sub-sigma algebra of F infinity, is uniformly integrable. Because again, they are just restrictions of functions like X infinity, the integrals are the same. Now, this by the optional stopping time theorem, which we had before, we know this identity for SK, which are bounded and finitely valued. Moreover, if SKs have finitely many values and one of them is infinity, then this is still true. Because what is it? So when I is just T1, T2, Tn, infinity, this is just finitely indexed martingale. It doesn't matter how I call the indexes. I can call them 1, 2, 3, 5, or I can call them 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 5, infinity. That's still the same martingale. So this identity holds even for SK, which are allowed to have infinite values, but they have finitely many values. Now, assume that SK has this finitely valued stopping times and SK converges to S from above. such a sequence does exist. Notice that FS is subset of FSK, because SK is bigger or equal than S, and here is the short proof. We know that for any set from FS, we have I intersect with S intersect with T belongs to FT. So this means that A intersect with a scalar less or equal than T. It's the same as A intersect with S less or equal than T intersect with a scalar less or equal than T, because this implies this. But this already belongs to FT. And this belongs to FT. So this intersection of two sets, which belongs to FT. So this intersection belongs to FT. So the set A itself belongs to FSK. Okay? So what do we have? A is an FS, A is an FSK. So integral over A of XXK is the same as the integral over A of X infinity. Because again, XSK is expectation of XS infinity with respect to FS and K. Now this converges almost surely, and that's why we use continuity. And that's uniformly integrable. So integral over A of XS is the limit of integrals over A XSK, which is we know integral over A of X infinity. So it means that XS is the expectation of X infinity with respect to FS. That's the end of the story. Okay, so here you should probably ask, well, this is all great, but why? Why cannot we just say that this is always true? Two stopping times, expectation of biggest stopping value of your Marcinkian, biggest stopping time at a smaller time, that would be your Marcinkian at the smallest stopping time. Let me show you an example why it's not true. So this is non-example. As you know, this XT expectation of Brownian motion with minus t over two. This is a martingale. This is not expectation, sorry, exponent. Since it's exponent, it's a positive martingale. And you know that bt minus t over two almost surely tends to minus infinity. That was one of our theorems that bt over t actually tends to zero. So bt minus t over 1/2 t tends to minus infinity. So this tends to minus infinity, then xt tends to zero almost surely. So martingale tends to zero almost surely. And then let's t be the first time that xt is less or equal than alpha. When alpha is less than one. T is good enough stopping time. Less than infinity almost surely, because we tend to zero, so eventually we will be less than alpha. But expectation of x at time t is just alpha, because this is the time we reached alpha, so we became alpha, which is not equal to expectation of x naught, which is just one. X naught is identically one. So really, we do need some conditions here. Now, since we have optional stopping time theorem, we can talk about stopped martingales. So let me run a bit late now, because, well, there were some interactions, and while I have internet connection, let me keep going. We'll have slightly shorter break, okay? So let me define stopped martingale. So xt is a martingale, t is a stopping time. XTT, as before, would be martingale, which is just XT up to time T. And then it's just X capital T. So this is a process which is measurable with respect to this exciting sigma algebra. So T's at time little t, this is just FT intersect with F capital T. So I claim that this stopped martingale is indeed a martingale. And fxt was uniformly integrable, so is the stopped martingale. Okay, let's play with it. First, let's assume that xt is uniformly integrable. And let's define capital S to be minimum of t and capital T. It's a stopping time, S is less or equal than t. So by optional stopping time theorem, xt at time t, well, this is xs by definition. This expectation of xt with respect to fs sigma algebra, and this is minimum of t, ft min t. So this xs is expectation of xt. And with respect to something. And so xt is thus uniformly integrable. Now, if xt was any martingale, let us fix s, then for up to the time it's uniformly integrable. So, well, here, sorry for the notation, we always have s less than t. Here, for some reason, I have t less than s. If t is less than s, then xtt is expectation of xst with respect to ft. Again, because we know that this is true for uniformly integrable martingales and up to time s, you are uniformly integrable. That's all. Okay, so now we are ready to move on to the quadratic variation. And so here, this is, I think, a good time to take a break. So let's take a 7-minute break. And at least I'll try to be back at noon Toronto time if the internet works. Okay, see you in 7 minutes.